I want to introduce Rob at this time. Rob and I are good friends. We've been together at different events for many years, and he's probably the best dressed speaker we will have. He probably belongs on GQ, I think it is, isn't it, Rob? But anyway, hard to compete with that. But Rob was appointed CEO of Air New Zealand in October of 2005. He began his career as an engineer with the Royal New Zealand Air Force attached to a fighter squadron. He has held a number of senior positions globally, including roles with the National Australia Bank, Telecom NZ, Bank of New Zealand, and the ITV Group in the UK. Rob joined Air New Zealand in 2003 and has held positions as Group General Manager Airlines and Chief Information Officer. Since Rob became CEO, the airline has consolidated its strong financial position, undertaken a significant fleet and route expansion, and has been recognized by many international awards. Air New Zealand has been particularly noted for its uniquely Kiwi customer experience. Please join again in welcoming Rob Fry.
Thanks, Bruce. It's great to be here from New Zealand winter to a sunny, warm New York. I thought I'd start this afternoon by just giving you a very quick overview of Air New Zealand so you can get a sense of who we are. We're actually a very small airline in the context of what you'd be more familiar with here in the USA. So we carry about 13 million passengers a year. We operate about 4,000 flights a week to 28 destinations in New Zealand and 28 destinations internationally. It's a pretty competitive market. There's 18 international carriers flying into New Zealand on the stretch of water between New Zealand and Australia, which is 1,500 miles. I think we've got 9 competitors on that route at the moment. So it's pretty intense. We've got 11,000 staff at Air New Zealand. And I guess interestingly, of what makes us a little different as well, our business is primarily tourism. So if you look at the people flying on our aircraft, over 70%, more than 2/3, are visitors coming to New Zealand for a holiday or returning from that holiday. So that's a little of who we are. In terms of that tourism component for our economy in New Zealand, tourism makes up almost 10% of GDP and about 18% of exports. So in that context, we're a very, very critical part of the New Zealand economic infrastructure. Despite being a very small airline from a very remote part of the world, we do try and make an impact. But before talking about how we work, I thought I'd start by taking you back to when I first joined Air New Zealand, which was in 2003. So at that stage, it was early 2003, it wasn't that long after the 9/11 attacks. Air New Zealand, prior to the 9/11 attacks, had brought us an airline in Australia called Ansett Australia. That airline actually went bust the same day as the 9/11 attacks. We don't have a concept of Chapter 11 in New Zealand, so when you go bust, you really go bust. And so the airline was struggling. And it had lost its way, I guess. And when I joined the airline, I can remember my very first day at work. We occupied 5 stories of a 21-story building in downtown Auckland. And I got up to my office, and I got out of the lift, and I went to my sit down in my office, and the chap from next door came in and introduced himself. And he said to me, he said, how was your journey in the lift? And I said, it was a journey in the lift, what do you mean? And he said, well, did you notice that anyone that was smiling had got out by the time you got to the 16th floor? And in fact, anyone that had a pulse had got out by the time they got to the 20th floor. And when I actually reflected back on it, he was right. When you walked around those floors, there was a real sense of doom and gloom and a sense of what a tough industry and how the airline had really lost its way. So my first job at Air New Zealand was to try and figure out what sort of strategy we should pursue to get the organisation back on its feet. We're trying to figure out, should we become a low-cost carrier? Should we be aim for global domination like Emirates? You know, what should our strategy be? And it was a struggle. As we went through all the analysis, the only thing that we could find that we did differently than any other airline was that we flew to and from New Zealand. So our question was, how could we make and create some sort of competitive advantage just by the mere dint of the fact that we operate to and from New Zealand and we're the only New Zealand-based carrier? So we thought we'd start by asking our customers, what is it that brings you to New Zealand? Why do you fly to New Zealand? And what they told us was typically stories of, well, I've seen pictures of mountains and jet boats and bungee jumping and beaches and Lord of the Rings, and you guys seem to keep winning the America's Cup. In fact, we'll have to rename it soon. You know, it's kind of, that's what draws me to New Zealand. But interestingly, and we did thousands of interviews, interestingly, when people left New Zealand, predominantly what they told us was about stories of people. And we asked them, you know, what memories are you going to take away with you? And they told us all these fabulous stories about people. And so we tried to distill what is it that makes Kiwis, New Zealanders, a little bit different. And so we ran a whole series of focus groups. And I can remember one vividly. I sat in on these focus groups. And I remember one American telling me vividly that he'd gone down the west coast of the South Island of New Zealand and he'd walked into a hotel. And he got drinking with these characters and, you know, they had a fabulous night and he went home with them. And the next day they took him out pig hunting and a bit like a scene from Deliverance, really. And he said, I just couldn't believe it. It was like, you know, I'd known these people all my life, yet I'd just arrived here in New Zealand. And so on. So we distilled all these stories and we tried to capture the essence of what makes that New Zealand personality a little bit unique. Because what we thought is if we could bring that personality to life through our organisation, then we could give people that sense that their holiday starts when they get on board the aircraft, not when they arrive at the destination, so that we could make that relatively long journey to New Zealand not an inhibitor, a barrier to coming and visiting our beautiful country. So we set about distilling all these stories and trying to identify what is that personality, and we identified four personality traits. And that was welcome everyone as a friend, be yourself. One of the things a lot of people told us about New Zealand is that it's not a place where you go and you get a lot of platitudes. Everyone says, have a nice day, but no one really means it. You actually meet real people, very authentic. They'll be happy, they'll be sad, they'll be funny, they'll be serious, but they're real, they're genuine, they're authentic, and people like that. The third attribute was this real sense of a can-do attitude, small country, but people just get on and make stuff happen. And the fourth attribute we identified was a sense of how people were prepared to share their sense of New Zealand with visitors to the country. So people said a lot of places you go and visit, it's like you're in the zoo on the bars looking in, but in New Zealand you feel like you can really get amongst it. So we took those four attributes and we said, well, let's make that the essence of our business. Our source of competitive advantage is going to be how we bring that personality to life throughout everything we do in our organisation. And I guess for the 7 or so years that I've been CEO, that's exactly what we've set out to do. But the challenge in doing that, and I guess this, I don't want this to sound like a motherhood statement, the challenge in doing that is to shift the centre of our business from being about planes to being about people. Because if the source of our competitive advantage is going to be the way we project this personality, then we had to make it all about people. And I thought I'd talk a little about the people of Air New Zealand and that personality. And the best way to do that is to share some stories with you. And I get hundreds of emails every week. And a lot of those for me now are customers writing to me and sharing stories with me. They're not all good. Some of them are complaints. But predominantly now, for every complaint I get between 3 and 4 compliments. And I thought I'd share a few examples of those stories to bring to life the way that personality that I've described manifests itself in Air New Zealand. And I'll share some good stories and some not so good stories. And the first one I thought I'd share, actually I'd just been in the job about 10 days, and we had a flight travelling from Wellington to Christchurch. It's relatively short duration. We had our Prime Minister on board, who at the time was a woman by the name of Helen Clark. And the aircraft was delayed with all the passengers boarded. They had a small mechanical fault, but they decided they'd leave the passengers on board. And so after 10 minutes or so, the Prime Minister decided that she was going to get off and get a charter flight down. I guess the President here doesn't typically fly in commercial aircraft, but this is New Zealand, so put it in perspective. And anyway, she got off the flight, and they just resolved the mechanical problem. The pilot came on with a PA announcement to say, we've solved the problem, but there'll be a further 10-minute delay while we get the Prime Minister's bags off the flight. She's getting a charter flight, and you would have thought she'd be more supportive of the national airline. That was the PA announcement. The main issue that we had is on the same flight was the leader of the opposition, so picture Mitt Romney, and so there was a loud round of applause from the rear of the aircraft. And so the first I knew about it was a phone call from the Prime Minister telling me what needed to be done to this pilot, and I mean, picture Salem witch trials and so on. I mean, it was she was in a foul mood. And so the dilemma for me at the time as CEO is, so what do you do? Here we are telling all our people that we want them to be themselves. This pilot thought he was being funny, apparently. But we've got a very regular customer, quite important person, happens to be a big shareholder, about 73% of the airline, feeling that she's been treated in a very disrespectful manner, which she had. How you deal with those individual situations that you're confronted with every day determines as to whether people really believe this personality exists in the organisation, or it's just a whole bunch of PR. So I was actually tortured by this issue for a couple of days, but the end result was that we decided we'd send this guy on a 2-day communications program with a comedian, which we told the Prime Minister was a remedial communications course. And everyone thought that was the right balance in that particular situation. But a positive story, and I would have thousands of these stories I could choose from. I had an email a few months ago from a woman who wrote to me, and she said, I was flying out of Christchurch, which is in the South Island, had some profile a year or so back when we had some very large earthquakes there. And she said, I was rushing for the flight. I had my 3-year-old and an 8-month-old under my arm. I was trailing a bag, and they'd already called my name because I was holding up the flight. I was flustered, and I got to the air bridge, and there was a chap, an Air New Zealand chap there in trousers and shirt, and he said, look, let me grab one of the kids in the bag, will get you to your seat. So she surprisingly willingly gave over a child and a bag to this chap. They got down the back of the aircraft. He was putting the bag up the top, and she said to him, is this your job, to pick up the stray passengers? And he said, No, my job's to get the aircraft off on time. I'm the pilot. And I was sitting in the cockpit and I saw you rushing through the window and I thought I'd come and give you a hand. And she said, sure enough, he went up the front and got in the cockpit and then they backed off and off they went. And she wrote to say to me, I don't think that would happen on any other airline. And I think that's possibly true. But they're not all good stories. And again, in terms of bringing that personality to life, I thought I'd share an email with you that I got from a customer. And I'd stress it wasn't an American. And the email starts off, Dear Sir. I'm always a bit nervous with the ones that start off, Dear Sir. And it reads like this. I'll censor it just slightly. I realise everyone in the audience is over 18, but even still. It says, I'd like to know how such incompetence occurs in the so-called airline of the year. I have a ticket in front of me on the same itinerary from Hong Kong to Christchurch, and I got air points on the way down and not on the way back. How does this occur in a computer system? And there's 10 question marks after that. So it's a joke. Why do I need to check? I never have this problem with a real airline. Then goes on to say, the effing lounge you use in Hong Kong, I'm abbreviating, he doesn't say effing, is a joke and an embarrassment to New Zealand and the people of New Zealand. You share with domestic airlines of mainland effing China and third world country airlines like Bangladesh, Pakistan and Sri Lanka. Why do I pay for this? McDonald's in the Hong Kong airport is nicer. Downstairs is a beautiful lounge from your Star Alliance partner, Singapore Airlines. Why not use that, you tight-ass mother effing? Joke, never again. I will switch back to Cathay Pacific, and the airline of my country is an effing joke. I don't get very many like this. It's occasional. I remember actually early on in my career, a very wise old head gave me some advice. He said, whenever you get really wound up by an email, he said, sleep overnight. Don't respond to it immediately. Sleep overnight and respond the next day. I never adhere to that advice. So here was my response I penned about 5 minutes later. In remembering, he closed out by saying, I'm going to switch back to Cathay Pacific. So I wrote back and said, Dear Simon, I'm in receipt of your note and I wholeheartedly support your proposal. I'd far rather someone so offensive as flying on the competition rather than flying with Air New Zealand. If there is any chance you could change your citizenship at the same time. That would be an excellent idea, as it embarrasses me that someone purporting to be a fellow New Zealander would engage with anyone in such an offensive tone. And I then went on to describe how, unfortunately, he actually hadn't gone to our lounge, it was someone else's, and his air points number wasn't in the booking correctly. But that generated quite a sporty exchange of views. The response to that email came back without prejudice, because he was quite offended, apparently, by my response. But I write out I do a blog every week or an email that goes out to our 11,000 staff. I included this whole email trail, censored slightly because we have a filter that would have stopped it going around everyone otherwise. And I thought it was really important to signal to our people this whole notion of treating everyone like a friend is a kind of two-way street. And if there becomes a limit where our customers may abuse our staff either verbally or physically from time to time, and they need to know that that's unacceptable, and this was a perfect way through a story to communicate where that standard sits in our organisation. Another example, I was on a flight going to Auckland to Hong Kong, and again we had a short delay. We pushed back from the gate and the one of the engines wouldn't start, so they put us back on the gate. They left us on the aircraft because to take us off we'd have to go all the way through customs and come back through again and so on. And while I was sitting there and I was fired up my PC and found one of these Wi-Fi hotspots and was doing a few emails, and an email popped up in my inbox from some chap, I can't remember his name, I didn't recognise the name, and it came up and I read it and it said, I'm sitting in row 43F with a couple of my mates and no one's offered us a beer yet. Do you think you could sort it out? And so, you know, as you do when you're the CEO, I guess you go into the galley and grab a six-pack of beers and wander off down the aircraft. And as I approached these guys at the back of the aircraft and I handed over the beers, I could see the crew scowling at me because, of course, everyone then pushed their buzzers and everyone wanted a beer and they had to do a whole drink service before we even took off. But interestingly, about 2 years after that, I was speaking at a Pricewaterhouse Partners conference in New Zealand. I was talking about Air New Zealand and customer service and so on. And I asked for questions at the end, and one chap got up at the end and said, well, I don't have a question, but I do want to tell a story. And he was one of these guys that I'd delivered the beers to, and he told this story from the other side. And it's just interesting the way those things work around. I thought I'd finish with probably a story I love to tell, and as I say, I could choose from many, many, but it's a story that kind of really brings, I think, the current personality of the organisation truly to life. I got an email from a customer, a very wealthy family that lives in the bottom of the South Island. This chap wrote to me and said, I'm really frustrated. He said, we pushed back from the gate. There was a 20-minute delay on the flight departing because they had to fix a problem with a heater. Surely we could have taken off with this heater, without this heater working. And he went on to say, in fact, my flights with Air New Zealand are never on time. And his closing line, actually, you'll start to wonder what New Zealanders are like, but his closing line was, your service is lower than a snake's scrotum. Now, in fact, we don't have snakes in New Zealand. So I had to kind of use my imagination, but I got a sense he was describing a low level of service. So anyway, I went back to this chap, and I apologised for the delay on the aircraft. It was a problem with a pedostatic heater. The pedo heater. I said to him, you know, it's a very critical flight safety issue. The pilot made the right decision. But in fact, our on-time performance record is very good, and 90% of our flights take off within 10 minutes, which is the best within the region. I think it was slightly unfair to say all your flights didn't take off on time. In fact, I'd gone back and checked, and that wasn't the case. So he then came back to me and said, well, I'd like to issue a wager to you that my next two flights won't be on time. And he'd like to wager two bottles of his best French red wine. And I went back and said, well, I'm up for your wager. I'm not a big drinker of French red wine, but we could put up 100 cans of beer. And so he said, right, that's good. So in my weekly message that week, I shared this email with all our 11,000 staff, along with the details of when his next two flights were. And we had hundreds of people making sure that these flights were on time. In fact, unbeknownst to me, and I didn't sanction this, and I probably wouldn't have, for one of those flights, I actually had a spare aircraft on standby in case we had a mechanical problem at all. And sure enough, his two flights not only left on time, they landed early. And he sent me the two bottles of red wine, and I got an email a couple of weeks later saying, did you enjoy the red wine? And I said to him, I haven't drunk. I went back by email and said, I haven't drunk it yet. If I had to share it with all the people involved in getting your flights off on time, it'd be a bit like communion. So I thought, I said, I'm being auctioned off for someone to come and spend a day with me and see what my job's about. I thought, we'll throw in your red wine. We might get a little bit more money. And on the basis of that, he then sent me another note saying, well, I'll send you a whole case of wine if it's going to a charity cause. And then someone ended up, they paid $18,000 to spend the day with me and then decided they didn't really like wine, so we got to auction the wine off for another couple of $1,000. And he goes around the country now telling everyone how he's my best mate and, you know, all this kind of stuff. So it was a great example, again, to use with our people to try and communicate how you can take a complaint, engage with a customer and see it as an opportunity to again project and respond with some sense of personality. So if I think what my role is as CEO of the organisation. I am the, I guess, the reference point for what this personality is and how it comes to life in our organisation. And telling stories is by far the most effective way that we communicate that sense of who we are and our identity to our people. I don't use the term, we never talk about vision, mission. I'll just fire that back up. Vision, mission, goals, strategies. We tend not to use that talk because if I'm out on the ramp talking to a group of baggage handlers, many of whom English may be a second language, about vision, mission, values, brand, all that kind of stuff, they just glaze over. They'll be thinking about the football game on the weekend, whatever. So we don't do that stuff. What we do is we share stories that give people a sense of how the way we do things and how we run our business. So bring that personality to life. We also try and project that through to our customers. And I thought I'd share a few video clips with you. And I was going to start with one for an advertising campaign we ran. And this advertising campaign was branded Nothing to Hide. And the theme was that we had no hidden fees and charges in our fares. We weren't charging extra for bags and all that kind of stuff. And we wanted to find a funny way to communicate that to our customers.
Sunday dreamers in a flash, fixing holes and sunken fast, and please don't blame me for my lies, just to keep him by my side. And I don't mind if Papa cares, or even if my mama stares, step right in, look right through, I beg you get to think the way I do. And I got you, I got you on.
In New Zealand, our fares have nothing to hide, which is why the price you pay includes everything, up front. Do you love a man in uniform?
So they were all Air New Zealand staff who decided that they would go naked apart from the body paint. But that was quite a high-risk campaign. I mean, when the advertising agency brought the idea to me, it kind of had the potential to be very, very tacky or potentially fantastic. You've always got to have a plan B to know how you're going to exit out of something like this pretty quickly if it doesn't work. But in the end of the day, it was groundbreaking. That particular campaign, and we did a safety video with people body painted as well, all up on YouTube, that got 14 million hits. In fact, 1 week it was the fastest growing YouTube video worldwide. We got the whole safety video played end-to-end on ABC, on the breakfast program, got worldwide coverage. In fact, at one stage, it was in 20,000 blog sites and newspaper sites around the world. Now, as a little airline sitting in New Zealand, it's very, very hard to get that sort of coverage. But it doesn't just work externally. That actually works really well internally in terms of the way that employees engage with it as well, and I thought I'd just show you a little bit of the behind the scenes making of that particular ad.
It's amazing, eh? This is the most extreme thing I've ever done.
My dad's not going to watch TV for a little while.
You do actually start to feel like you're getting dressed slowly.
Do you? And so you can touch it. It's okay to work with.
It's such a fantastic thing to do, to involve your own employees, I think, in adverts, because it gives a level of authenticity. And for these guys, they're just buzzing, you know?
A little bit nervous.
It's going to be so funny, man, when I see it on TV. Yeah, to represent in New Zealand at the same time. It's a bonus.
Only my wife knows at the moment. I guess the rest of the floating world is going to find out shortly.
I got you under my kiss, and I got you over my lips, and I got you
I'm really glad I got to be a part of it. Definitely remember this one for a long time.
I walk around on my G-string for New Zealand anytime.
I would do it again, actually.
It's a big privilege just to be a part of it.
When I first read the scripts, I thought that they were absolutely brilliant. Fantastic idea.
It's only my idea if it works out to be very, very good.
Very brave.
Well, no, it's quite brave.
It still feels surreal. I think for me, it'll probably just hit me once I get downstairs and see people.
I feel naked.
I think the New Zealand staff who appear in this commercial need to have a big pat on the back.
Seeing the guys that I was working with, Michael and Hillman, just so into it.
I think it's amazing that the staff have got behind this as much as they have done.
And our job really is to bring it to life.
Going to work to bring a personality to life in an organisation and make it real, you have to do that through every facet of what you do. And I thought I'd just show one more video clip, which I mentioned we then extended into onboard safety videos, and we've made kind of our safety videos one of those quirky expressions of our identity as well. And I won't show you the body painted one, you've probably seen more than enough. The next one, we had the World Cup Rugby in New Zealand last year, and so we did a safety video that was centred around the All Black rugby team, which is the New Zealand team, which ultimately won the Rugby World Cup, with a number of players involved in the safety video. And this is that.
Welcome aboard this Air New Zealand flight. Shortly, we'll be winging our way to your next port of call. But before we kick off, I'd like to give you a quick safety team talk. Even if you fly with us often, please keep your eyes on the briefing.
To warm up, make sure all your baggage is stored away in the overhead compartments. Or tucked under the seat in front of you.
Whether you're on the front row or the back, all passengers must keep an eye on the lighted signs and follow the crew's instructions.
With the seatbelt sign switched on, nip back to the seat and fasten your seatbelt.
Not so tight that you'll lose feeling in your legs, but enough to make sure it's snug across your hips. We recommend you keep your seatbelt fastened throughout the flight, but if you need to get up to stretch your hammies, undo the seatbelt by lifting the flap.
Excuse me.
If an oxygen mask should drop down in front of you, don't stop to ask why.
Simply pull down on the mask, place over your nose and mouth, and tighten by pulling the elastic on both sides. Oxygen will flow through the mask automatically.
If there are young ones around you, make sure you've got your mask on before helping them out. Then look around, as there may be someone else who needs a hand.
If an emergency were to happen during takeoff or landing, place your hands on your head with your elbows on the outside of your thighs and feet flat on the floor.
Or crouch, touch, and brace yourself on the seat in front of you.
And down here is the perfect place to find your life jacket.
Life jackets are really easy to use.
Simply rip it out of the bag and put it over your head like this. Then clip the straps together and tighten. This red tab inflates the life jacket, so only pull it once you leave the aircraft. If you need to inflate a little bit more, simply blow into the mouthpiece, like this.
We'll also be on hand to provide life jackets for infants if needed.
If you find yourself needing to smoke on this flight, consider yourself dropped. Smoking anywhere on the plane is not allowed, and we can't have that kind of disruption in the team.
If you need to find your way out, even if it's all black, escape path lighting will lead you to the exit. Should we need to evacuate, support others around you who require help.
Your crew are now pointing out the exits.
It would pay to note that your nearest exit could be behind you. So have a quick look and count the number of rows to the exit. You'll find more information on the safety card in your seat pocket.
Please turn off all electronic devices during takeoff and landing. Electronic devices such as mobile phones can interfere with aircraft systems and mustn't be used in flight unless you've switched them to flight mode.
Finally, for takeoff, we ask that you place your tray table back, make sure your seat is upright, and fasten your seatbelt.
And then we'll be taking off, without any more surprises.
This is your pilot speaking. It's a pleasure having you all on the team today. Please sit back, relax, and enjoy our great Kiwi service.
From the airline that's crazy about rugby, kia ora, and have a great flight.
We knew the video, we were slightly nervous about 80-year-old Betty streaking her down the aisle at the end. So we did have a plan B in case Betty didn't work.
The bare facts are that the people of Southwest have great talent. We'll save the body paint for next year, or maybe starting right now.
But it's not all about just, I guess, stories and ad campaigns. And I thought I'd just take a couple of minutes and talk about some of the reality of what all this personality means for me and my job. As I mentioned, I write an email every week to our 11,000 employees, and it actually doesn't matter what I'm doing. Even if I'm on holiday with the family, I'll still write an email to our employees. They feel it's a way to connect every week with what's going on in the business, what I'm up to. One day a month, I go and work somewhere in the business. So I've worked as a baggage handler, I've worked cleaning toilets on the 747s, I've worked in the telephone centre, I've worked as a flight attendant. You'll be glad to know I haven't worked as a pilot, but basically every job in the business I try and go and spend some time doing those jobs and work a full shift, not just pop up and do a photo op and disappear away again. In fact, most times when I fly, I'll get up and help do the tea and coffee with the crew. It's very easy to do. Similarly, one day a month, we have an employee from somewhere in the business come and spend a day with me and see what my job's about. And they sit through all my meetings and get an experience of my job, which they can take back and share with their colleagues. All my team of direct reports, my executive team, they all do the same thing. Even our non-executive directors go out and spend one day a quarter working somewhere in the business to familiarise themselves with the business. I meet every new employee that joins the company. We get about 1,000 new employees joining a year. I meet them in groups, and predominantly what I talk about is the sense of personality, the sense of identity, and what it takes to be what we refer to as an Air New Zealander. We use video extensively to communicate with our employees. When we do our annual results briefing last year, we had 4,000 employees watching that live on their computer screens. That's out of a total population that were accessible to be able to watch of about 5,000 to 5,500. So we try and have a very open dialogue with our employees, Air New Zealanders, in terms of what's going on around the business. I respond to all the email traffic that comes to me from customers or employees personally. So that's about 100 emails a day, up to 1,000 a week. 30% of those now come through Facebook. And it's interesting, that number is growing quite quickly. People feel more confident that it's got through to you if they send it through Facebook. It's a big chunk of my time, actually. We invest very heavily in training and development. For example, in July or September each year, we hire one of the boarding schools during the holiday break, and we run a leadership program, and we do 1,200 of our employees come through during that two-week period and can get courses on anything from marketing to flight safety, principles of flight, accounting, corporate governance. We run a couple of hundred courses. We also do a lot to include our families in what's going around. Every Christmas, actually, in New Zealand, we hire out a whole bunch of zoos for the day, and we have these zoo days with bands, and the kids can run around, and we put on a barbecue and picnics and the likes. And the really important thing, particularly for our Pacific Island families, where the definition of family can be quite a large group of people, then people can bring along whoever they want. And last year, I think, at those events, we have about 9,500 of our employees are in New Zealand. We had 22,000 people attend those zoo events, but we run concerts, pop concerts and so on as well. So absolutely critical is this whole ethos is about communication, it's about engagement, it's about being very open and being very accessible. The culmination of that for us has been a whole slew of awards. We've won the ATW Airline of the Year Award twice in the last 3 years. This year and last year, we've been recognised by the public as New Zealand's most respected company. This year and last year, we won the award as New Zealand's most attractive employer. And there's been a slew of another 30 awards that we've won over the last 18 months. We've been consistently profitable over the last decade. Condé Nast magazine, we won the Innovation and Design Award for our Sky Couch economy seat, which was an interior innovation that we developed where we can turn a set of three economy seats into a sleeping or a lounging platform for a couple. Vanity Fair's Best Premium Economy, UK Design Week magazine's Best Furniture Design Award, Wallpaper Design's Best Air Style Awards for our Premium Economy seat. All that innovation is coming and bubbling up from within our organisation, driven by the open communication and a very clear sense of what this personality within Air New Zealand is all about. And when you think of the backdrop for that, we've had earthquakes, we've clearly had a global financial crisis, we've had SARS, we've had bird flu, high oil prices. We haven't allowed that to distract us from constantly bringing this personality to life within our organisation. So that's a very quick snapshot of, I guess, a slightly different approach to managing an airline than you'd see from most. I like to think that we dare to be a little different, we dare to have a personality, and we dare to be a leader in the industry. Ours is a story of a little airline at the bottom of the world using a little Kiwi personality and cheek to not only get delivered, but to consistently deliver shareholder value and a great customer experience. Thank you.
Thank you, Rob. Air New Zealand looks like a fun airline, doesn't it?
It's presented to Rob Fry in grateful appreciation for your presentation at the Aviation Leaders Series of the Wings Club, New York City, June 2012.
Great. Thanks, Bruce. Great. Thank you.